The surgeon fixing your injured groin discovered you had a rare penile cancer. What happened next?
I knew before we got the diagnosis that they were going to have to amputate. It was obvious.
You lived without a penis for more than 4 years. What was that like?
I guess it cramped my dating style, I guess. You know, I wasn't going on too many dates, you know. Can't go online or whatever and say, hey, you know, you're looking for a guy without a penis? Well, then I'm your guy.
How did doctors respond back then when you asked for a penis transplant?
Dr. Feldman thought I was crazy. And it probably was. Every time he saw me, when I woke up out of the surgery, I turned around and one of the first words I said to him was like, okay, now we're going to start thinking about the transplant, right? He says, they don't do that stuff.
Curtis, you're a plastic and reconstructive surgeon. At what point did you think that penile transplants were possible?
So we had performed a hand transplant in a very badly burned patient who was involved in a nightclub fire, which is pretty well known in these parts. And we screened many patients, and like our hand transplant patient, Mr. Manning became very highly recommended because he was such a good patient going through his cancer therapy. He was very compliant. And it was really his courage that helped us pick him as the first person.
How complicated is the procedure to transplant a penis?
It's a very delicate procedure that you use microsurgical techniques where you're operating under a microscope to put all the fine structures together and make sure that they function. So it was a long case, but it went well, and it certainly was within the purview of what we're able to do with modern microsurgical technique.